In this video, I will try to explain as simple as possible the concept of pointers and how you can use them in a practical manner. For example, have a look at this line. Looks complicated, doesn't it? At the end of this video, you will understand what this line does and how you can use it in your own projects. Okay, the easiest way to explain pointers is by using an example. Let's say that I have built a balancing robot with the Amiga328P. That is the microcontroller used on various Arduino boards. And I want to store some variables in the EEPROM of the microcontroller. The EEPROM is a non-volatile memory that will remember the data even after the power has been turned off. To do this, I will use the Arduino Uno that will run my example programs, and the EEPROM library that is part of the standard Arduino IDE. In my example program, I use a byte and a float that I want to store in the EEPROM and later read it back to the check variables. On the EEPROM write reference page, we can find the syntax of the EEPROM write function. This function will write the data to the EEPROM of the Amiga328P. All we need is a memory address represented as an integer and the value that we want to store in the EEPROM in the form of a byte. And for those who forgot, one byte holds 8 bits and gives us 256 possible combinations varying between 0 and 255. For your information, the EEPROM of the Amiga328P only has 1024 memory locations, meaning that we can only store 1024 bytes and that the memory address must be between 0 and 1023 as we start counting from 0. Okay, that sounds relatively easy. If I want to store my byte variable, I can simply use this line. The value of the byte variable will be stored in the EEPROM memory location 0. As a confirmation, I will read back the value from the EEPROM and print the check byte variable on the serial output. Needless to say, but during the readback, the EEPROM memory location needs to be the same. So if I now run the program, you can see that both variables have the same value, meaning that the write-read cycle worked. Well, that wasn't so hard. Now let's have a look at the float variable. And you might already guessed it, a float is not a byte. However, all data in the microcontroller is stored in the form of bytes, and floats are no exception. To better understand of what is going on, we need to understand the concept of floats. On the float reference page, we can see that a float is stored as a 4-byte value when we use the Amiga328P. Meaning that in the static random access memory or SRAM of the microcontroller, 4 bytes are used to store the float variable. Simplified, it looks like this. This cell represents the first byte of the SRAM memory. As it is a byte, it holds 8 bits. With every cell, the address is incremented by 1. Because the Amiga328P has 2K of SRAM, there are 2048 memory address locations. In the datasheet of the Amiga328P, we can find the start address of the SRAM memory, in this case 0x100 in hexadecimal form, and it ends at address 08FF, also in hexadecimal form. So basically, all I want to do is to copy these 4 bytes individually to the EEPROM and later write them back to the check float variable. And as you probably guessed it, we will use pointers to get this to work. Okay, first things first, what is a pointer? A pointer makes it possible to create another object or variable that points or is coupled to a certain memory location. The memory location where the pointer is coupled to is stored inside the pointer itself. As an example, Here I have declared a float variable that is located over 4 bytes somewhere in the SRAM memory. I will also declare a float pointer that you can recognize by the asterisk. I can now connect the pointer to the float address via this line. Because I'm changing the pointer address, the leading asterisk is removed. The ampersand is the address of operator and will return the address location of the float variable as a 16-bit integer. I will also add some extra lines so we can see the various outputs on the serial monitor. First, I will output the hexadecimal address of the float variable. Now it's important to use the correct data types, as the result of the address of operator is a 16-bit integer. However, the variable itself is a float. If I compile this code, the compiler returns an error and tells me that it can choose between various options. To make it clear that the compiler has to handle it as an integer, I will cast or force the result of the address of operator to the data type integer. Next, the value of the float variable and the value of the pointer is printed to the serial monitor. Because I want to read the coupled memory location of the pointer, I add the asterisk in front of the pointer. When I want to read the address where the pointer is coupled to, the asterisk is removed. When I run this program, we can see that the start address of the float variable is 0x100 in hexadecimal form, and that both the float variable and the pointer hold the same value. This is as expected, because the pointer is coupled to the same memory location of the float variable. Fun fact, the 100 address in hexadecimal form is the first address of the SRAM memory, as you can see here in the datasheet. So we know that it is a valid memory address. Okay, this makes sense so far, as it is pretty straightforward. If not, please watch this part again until it makes sense. Now it's time to use the real power of pointers. In our program, we declared the pointer as a float, because that is what we wanted to access. However, it's also possible to use other data types. Because we need to write a single byte to the EEPROM, I will focus on that. So, I will change the data type of the pointer to a byte. To connect the pointer to the address location of the float, I have to explain to the compiler that it has to connect it as a byte and not a float. To do this, I need to cast the data type of the pointer address location to a byte like this. Now the compiler will handle this pointer as a byte instead of a float, and this makes it possible to print the first byte of the float variable like this. To print the second byte of the float, the pointer address has to be incremented by 1. And we can simply do this by adding the increment operator to the pointer. When we do this, the memory address of the pointer is incremented after the read. So, it will read the address location, and after that, it will automatically increment to the next memory location. This way, I can add the remaining 3 bytes like this. When I now run the program, we get the individual hexadecimal values of the 4 bytes that hold the float value. And to make sure that the code is working correctly, I can calculate the original float value from the 4 bytes that we have extracted from the SRAM. First, I will convert the hexadecimal values to bits. The first bit is our sign bit. When 1, the float value is negative. When 0, the float value is positive. So we already know that it will be a positive value. The next 8 bits represents the exponent that we will use later. We can calculate the value like any other unsigned byte value. So the first bit represents a 1, the second bit a 2, the third bit a 4, and so on. By adding the values of the bits that are 1, we get a value of 130. As the exponent can be positive and negative, we need to subtract 127 from the result. The 127 is a given number that we simply have to use, resulting in an exponent of 3 that we will use later. The last 23 bits are fraction bits and represents the actual value of the float. Because the way this works, I will add a leading 1 and get a 24-bit value. The first bit of the 24-bit value is always a 1. In contrast to a normal byte, the bit values of the fraction work a little different. The first bit represents a 1. The second bit represents the half of the first bit. So 1 divided by 2 equals 0.5. The next bit also represents the half value of the previous bits and equals 0.25. And this goes up to the last bit. To make this more convenient, I will use an Excel sheet where the rows represents the 24 bits. So first bit represents a 1. The second bit is the first bit divided by 2, and so on. Column B represents my 24-bit value, and whenever a bit is 1, the representation of the byte is copied to column C. The result of column C is printed here. Now I can fill in the individual bits. 10, 10, 00, 10, 0001, 01, 00011111011. And we have a result of 1.26625 and so on. Last thing that we need to do is to multiply the outcome by the exponent 3 that we calculated earlier. So 2 to the power of 3 multiplied by the result will give us a value that will come close to the original 10.13 that we originally stored in the float variable. It's not spot on, because that is simply how a float works. For example, if I change the last bit, you can see that the result is now smaller than 10.13. So there is no way to get a perfect 10.13 value with a 4-byte float. In short, the pointer method is working, and we can now store the individual bytes in the EEPROM. The same pointer method can be used to restore the check float value from the EEPROM, as you can see here. When I now run the code, you can see that both the original float value and the check float value are the same. And basically, you can use this method for all data types, as long as you know the numbers of bytes that are used by the specific data type. Remember that line that I showed in the beginning of the video? This line makes it possible to directly change or access any byte in the SRAM memory. So it uses a pointer to address 100 in hexadecimal form. Because the pointer is cast to a byte, it's possible to change the value of that specific byte to 0xFF in hexadecimal form. This way you can read and write any individual byte in the SRAM memory. And that is one of the powerful things that you can do with pointers. And that wraps it up for this video. As always, I hope you learned something new and that you can use this knowledge in your future projects. Thank you for watching and see you next time.